Welcome to our summer election extravaganza. Actually, it was supposed to be the fall election extravaganza, but the air conditioning decided otherwise. I'm Chuck Howell, I'll be your moderator today. And right now, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce the Dean of Libraries, Dr. Babak Hamidzadeh. Let's hear it.
Good afternoon and welcome to the University of Maryland Libraries. It's great to see a room full of people for an event like this. It's the third of its kind of this series or this program we call Interdisciplinary Dialogues. The name hopefully speaks for itself. We feel that this is the libraries are the perfect place for having this kind of this interdisciplinary activity. The libraries serve all the disciplines, we work with all the different academic departments, and as such, you know, our librarians are very familiar with the kinds of topics that are being addressed and worked on in various disciplines, and when they get together and talk, they can really bring a lot of interesting conversation to the table and the kinds of topics to be discussed that are interdisciplinary. In fact, we feel that as librarians, we can at times bring topics to the table or problems to work on that an individual researcher or expert in a field may not do so when they're just focused on one aspect of the problem. So we're very excited about this program and we hope to expand it and turn it into workshops and other things. Lily Griner has been instrumental in initiating and conceiving this whole program, and I'd like to thank her for all her effort. The Research Commons sponsored this whole activity as part of our Research Commons program and initiative, and the Research Commons is there to bring all various phases of the research lifecycle under one umbrella, and hopefully you know that this fits right into that program very nicely. So with that, I would like to thank you again for coming and wish you a great program. I hope you enjoy the presentations and take part in the conversation. And I'll hand it back to Chuck to introduce the speakers. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So before we get started, I want to point out this marvelous library guide that was created by our own Judy Markowitz. But this is on the library website. You can find it either under Judy's name or under, you see here, subject-specific guides, U.S. election and voting. And it's got just a wealth of resources, some online, some are actual books. You've heard of those, I know. Databases, news sources, it's all right here at your fingertips. So I suggest you follow along during tonight's debate and fact check using this site. Let me move it right along and introduce our first speaker, Dr. Shawn J. Parry-Giles, who is a professor and chair of the Department of Communication and also the director of the Center for Political Communication and Civic Leadership here at the university. Her research centers on the study of rhetoric and politics with a focus on the study of the presidency, and she is the author or co-author of 5 books, including Memories of Lincoln and The Splintering of American Political Thought, which was written with David S. Coffer, Hillary Clinton in the News, Gender and Authenticity in American Politics, and The Rhetorical Presidency, Propaganda and the Cold War, 1945 through 1955. Which was designated as a Choice Outstanding Academic Title for 2002. She's published in numerous journals as well, including Communication Monographs, Critical Studies in Media Communication, the Journal of Communication, and the Journal of Language in Politics. In addition, Parry-Giles is a co-editor of an NEH-funded project and journal entitled Voices of Democracy, the U.S. Oratory Project, which she runs with J. Michael Hogan. She will be speaking on social media messages in Hillary Clinton's 2016 campaign and how they relate to the political identities that have been featured in her speeches and memoirs over the past 25 years. Dr. Shawn Parry-Giles.
Good Good afternoon. I want to thank Lily for organizing this, and Chuck, as well as the library. It's a great pleasure to be able to talk about this research. So as Chuck mentioned, I'm working on a larger project about Hillary Clinton's speeches. I'm doing this work with David Koffer at Carnegie Mellon. And so we're looking at speeches for when she was first lady, when she became senator, when she was secretary of state, as well as a presidential candidate. And then we're also studying her memoirs, and we're looking at her identities, the different identities that she's formed in these different kinds of writing. So we're trying to understand this by looking very closely at her language. I'm a humanist, so I don't normally do this kind of, I've learned how to do this kind of research, but normally most of my work is more humanistic. But David has created a text mining software package that you can load all the speeches and run it through the process, and then it categorizes the speeches according to the same categories. A lot of you may be very familiar with this research. So the dictionary that he's created over the last almost 20 years with a colleague at CMU has like 50 million patterns of languages and words embedded within the dictionary that all new texts are compared to. And then there are like 25 top-level categories that the words are divided into, and 80 mid-level categories, and 180 finer-level categories. What I'm going to talk about today is more the kind of top-level categories and the way that the language is divided up. So some of these include like public language. Is the language more public? Is it more personal? Is it more negative emotion, positive emotion, negative relations, and so forth? And so I'll be talking about some of these categories. But what it does is that you can take the a diverse amount of text, run it through the program, and it's going to categorize the language in the exact same way for every text that it runs through. And then once we get the result, it is analyzed by through statistical programs, and that's the part I don't do, is the statistical programs. But we then get factors or components, and once we have that, then David's an English professor, and so we're both then analyzing the results as humanists. We're interpreting the results more humanistically. So again, once we started looking at the different ways in which she speaks publicly and across the different roles or writes in her memoirs, we started to compare what we see as her governing style when she's First Lady, Secretary of State, or Senator, compared to her campaign style. The campaign work is ongoing because we're not done with it. We're still collecting speeches from the general election. But we do have the results from the memoirs, and we have the results from the 2008 primary, and then we have the results from her time as First Lady through Secretary of State. So we do have a lot of the results. I think what I found surprising when looking at the results from, we just received them not long ago on the 2008 primary. So we compared Obama's speeches from 2008 to Clinton's speeches from 2008 to see what the distinctions were. And we were surprised to find that, he tends to be more wonkish than she tends to be. And that was not something that we expected, because Hillary as a political wonk seems to be her go-to style of speaking, that she seems most comforted when she is in this kind of wonkish kind of mentality. And so when we ran the comparison with Obama, we expected that he was going to be potentially more interactive because he generated high levels of enthusiasm when he spoke. What we found was that she's much more interactive in her language style than he was interactive in his language style. The wonkishness comes out, if any of you read Hard Choices, it was not widely, did not sell well. But it is, if you care about foreign policy, it's fascinating because she takes you through every intricate detail of her foreign policy experiences when she was Secretary of State. And so it really kind of sets the stage for her foreign policy mission if she were to be elected president. But the language tends to be a wonkish language. It's very public, it's very academic, it's very strategic. So she's using words like state-owned and markets and strategic interests. She's talking about fair systems. It's not a language that most people are going to find terribly engaging. But when she is on the campaign trail, you see this interactivity kick into play. So her language is much more like, I'm beginning a conversation with you. You know, she's not talking about strategic interests only in that way. Or so she intertwines this notion of first person I with a reference to the audience as you. And we also found that even when she's academic on the campaign trail, it's still an interactivity among it. So that she may talk about supporting energy efficiency, which is a very kind of academic ease, followed by, because I want to do what's right for your family. And so she takes that shift from this academic prose to making it relevant to her family or to the audience members. So that's a backdrop. But what I did for today's panel is to take 60 tweets from Hillary Clinton and run it through the same software package to see, is her style of tweeting different than her style of speaking or her style of writing? I also did the same thing for Donald Trump because I figured you would want to know how it might compare to the tweets of Donald Trump. And I was surprised by the comparison. And I will say as a caveat that I did not do the statistical analysis on this part of it because that's not what I do. So I didn't run it through the software. We have actually have a person with a PhD in stats who handles our stats. So that's not my role on the project. But through just looking at the software results or running through the DocuScope program, you can see surprisingly, I was surprised at least, that both Trump and Clinton tend to use high levels of academic language and interactive language, and that was not what I expected to find. And so what I think is, some of the others may talk about, is that when he tweets, most of my experience with Donald Trump tweeting, I'm not on his Twitter, I'm not on anybody's Twitter actually, but most of his tweets are very negative, and that's what we see on the news. And that they only play up those really highly negative tweets. But if you go into and read all of his tweets, he has a lot more informative tweets. He'll talk about his events, and he will talk about, you know, his positions on issues. And that's where this kind of academic language is coming through. So he talks about global warming, he talks about concessions to Cuba, and he talks about U.S. manufacturing being and non-competitiveness of it. Just as Clinton talks about financial ties, specialty markets, and the global economy. And then they both kick in with some interactivity language, but what's different for this interactivity is that they're talking to one another. And so that whereas Clinton may be talking to the audience in a speech, here Twitter, like ads, they debate each other and they bait each other. So they say these incendiary things to try to get a reaction from the other. So you may have Hillary Clinton saying to Donald Trump, which is highly interactive language, while refusing to release your taxes, how will you confirm that you do not have dangerous financial ties to bad actors around the world? That loaded high on interactivity, even though she's really interacting with Donald Trump. And Trump, in turn, would tweet something like, whereas your 33,000 emails that you, where are your 33,000 emails that you deleted? And so they're debating each other back and forth. She does, though, to have more interactivity in other ways that he does not use as much. And so she still kicks back into phrases like, let's get this done. So it's interacting with the audience or saying, vote your conscience and make sure you're registered. He has tweets where he talks about making sure you're registered, but she tends to address the audience more directly than he does. There are also just a few other differences between them. Trump tends to use more first-person language, which is probably not that surprising. He talks about himself a lot. His prose is more forceful, and that's probably not surprising either. And then he uses expository devices, which I'll explain, give you examples. So the forceful language is mostly because great loads up as a forceful term, and so anytime he says great, make America great again, that scores high on that factor. So that's part of the reason he's forceful. For first person, Trump again uses a lot of I and me references. So one example, he tweeted that a new poll indicates that 68% of my supporters would vote for me if I departed the GOP. So he's clearly putting the emphasis on him and in a way of disregarding the GOP. And in terms of expository devices, this is evidence for the arguments that he's making on Twitter. This loads heavily if there's numbers involved, and given how he loves to talk about poll numbers, that's why he's loading so high. Because a lot of tweets he's talking a lot about is Twitter, and here's poll numbers. So some of his examples are, he would say 100% fabricated, which could be about a lot of things, but if that was about the sexual assault charges, then that was his response. or he would say, number one trend on Twitter right now is hashtag Trump won the debate, even when that wasn't necessarily the case, he would still say so. And then he would target Paul Ryan and others, give zero support to me, you know, and that zero made it load up on expository. So I think, obviously, if we were to include this within the larger study, and we might, we would need more than 60 tweets, and we would need to run it through the statistical package, because what the stats do is really show fine-tuned differences between the language usage. But the first look, I think there's some conclusions that we can draw from this, that there is a consistency across Clinton's campaign style and her tweeting style, which I did not necessarily expect to see. There's also greater consistency amongst Trump and Clinton than I expected to see just by looking at the Twitter feeds that are reported in the news. And in the end, we may be able to see that there is a campaign style that moves across the candidates, because we're looking at her in relationship to Obama, in relationship to Sanders, and then and to Trump. But I think in the end that we probably are going to see fine-grained distinctions that the program will allow us to see, and I think it's going to be fascinating to ultimately be able to look at how she speaks differently across these different roles and across these different topics. Thank you.
All right, we're going to hold the questions for all of our participants until the end and try to get a nice conversation going. So I'm going to now introduce our dynamic duo, Sarah Oates and Wendy Moe. Sarah Oates is a professor and senior scholar at the Philip Merrill College of Journalism and is an expert on media and democracy. Her work includes studies of U.S., Russian, and British elections, and the politics of fear. Her most recent book, Revolution Stalled, The Political Limits of the Internet and the Post-Soviet Sphere, which came out in 2013, found a reason for faint optimism in how Russians were aggregating political interests online. She's a specialist in content analysis, particularly concerning national news broadcasts. And for the 2016 election, she's conducting a study of the relationship between traditional media and Twitter in spreading campaign branding for Trump and Clinton. Dr. Wendy Moe, her co-author of what we're going to be hearing today, is a professor of marketing and director of the Masters of Science in Marketing Analytics at the School of Business here at the university, and she holds a BS, an MA, and a PhD from the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania, and also has an MBA from Georgetown. She's an expert in online and social media marketing with a focus on analytics and intelligence. Professor Moe consults for numerous corporations and government agencies, helping them develop and implement state-of-the-art statistical models in the area of web analytics, social media intelligence, and forecasting. She serves on the Board of Trustees for the Marketing Science Institute, the Advisory Board for the Wharton Consumer Analytics Initiative, and the editorial boards of the Journal of Marketing, the Journal of Marketing Research, and the Journal of Interactive Marketing. She's also the author of Social Media Intelligence, which came out in 2014. And together with Dr. Oates, they co-authored Donald Trump and the Oxygen of Publicity, Branding, Social Media, and Mass Media in the 2016 Presidential Election. And that was presented at the American Political Science Association annual meeting. And so Dr. Oates is going to present some of their work, and Dr. Moe will add comments as she likes, and will participate in the Q&A. Dr. Oates?
Thank you. I'm going to, I'm not sure my time limit is. It's important to tell academics what their time limit might be. So I'm just going to pull up the presentation here. And thank you, everyone, for coming out and, you know, and staying engaged in an election that at times we could all just want to run and hide under the bed and not really deal with it anymore. So I'm just also going to think about how I So you can download our paper in all its glory from SSRN, where I'm pleased to say it's been consistently making the top 10 in political behavior, which suggests a sexy title is a good thing. And I would like to take a moment to thank the UMD Advanced Program. This is from a C grant from UMD Advance, which is committed to an excellent workplace for women and for everyone on campus and an inclusive workplace. It also has some intellectual roots in the Future of Information Alliance, FIA, and I would encourage everyone to check out FIA UMD online. They're running another C grant program, this one with virtual and augmented reality. So without further ado, that's thanks to all the sponsors. Let's get started. So Wendy and I set out to find whether business social media applications would help us in the study of political communication. So I'd been studying elections for about 20 years, and I think Wendy had been spending a similar amount of time looking at branding and latterly branding and how it plays out on social media. And so we thought, okay, well, let's try to be modern in the 21st century and combine these two disciplines, and can you study candidates as brands? And Wendy and I naively thought it would be, you know, like an election, you know, like a normal election with platforms and candidates and discourse, and it really happened, and it's a little messy, but we will show you what we found. And if I were going to be really honest, which is probably a mistake, I would say that Professor Parry-Giles has the method, and we have the huge amount of data. So she's winning methodologically. But we got a lot of stuff, so I'm going to show you what we found. So we started with Wendy's work in social media intelligence, which argues that, and she can articulate this better in the Q&A, but which essentially argues that you can't look at one particular platform or one particular place to understand how brands project themselves across social media. You really need to look at the interplay across different platforms as well as different sub-attributes of brands. So I'm much more into traditional content analysis. So now I'm going to say here, the general conviction was we were trying to do what Moe and Schweidel, did. And this is Wendy's work on the social media brand tracker dashboard, which is really hard to say, I have to say. But what it does is, as you can see, it gives you an overall score, in which case it's going down. And then it talks about the brand awareness, which are the bar graphs. This is Twitter mentions, Facebook mentions, and blog mentions. And then you have different sub-attributes of brands. And this is what I kind of globbed onto. For example, here, the user preference, security, price, you know, different things you might find, for example, in an electronics product or in a travel product, the different things you might see. So we may love a product because it's cheap, but we don't really like its reliability very much. I'm not going to make any allusions to candidates there, but you see where I'm going with this. So the idea was, what we're going to try to do is to break down candidates into the sub-attributes of their brands. And we had a kind of feeling that the Democrats would be talking about healthcare and talking about, if at all, social justice and talking about the economy in a certain way, and that the Republican candidates would be talking probably more about security, talking about economics, and coming up with different sub-attributes of their brand. I naively and foolishly thought that all the candidates would put this on their websites during the primary, and so the first kind of whoops moment was when I went to all the Republican websites in the primary and no one listed any issues. This should have been a kind of warning bell that this was going to be a weird election, but never one to be deterred by lack of obvious evidence. As a social scientist, we kept going, and we decided that, the Democrats are the people who sit in front of the class and talk all the time. You know, they're like the really annoying people who know stuff and want to tell you about it. So they all had elaborate issue candidate, you know, on there. Even people who were never going to win had actually written, you know, statements about issues and put them up in a way you could code them. Bless their little socks. But we couldn't do much with that because the Republicans didn't have them. So in a panic, or perhaps in a careful, well-reflected way, we thought, okay, well, we'll look at Twitter, because, you know, these guys are all tweeting. So we thought, okay, we'll capture their Twitter. We'll go to our favorite place, the Pew, I can't think of their name right now, Pew Research Center. We'll look at what Democrats are interested in issues, and we'll look at what Republicans are, and we'll try and find them in their Twitter by gum. So we came up what we have elegantly called the campaign message flow model, but which we secretly call the spaceship model, because that's what it looks like. And we said, okay, so we're interested here. We've got the candidates who are tweeting out. Sometimes they tweet directly to the public. Sometimes they tweet about stuff that's covered in the traditional media. The traditional media is covering the candidates, and people are responding to that. So you can see where we tried to set up this relationship among the people who are broadcasting their brands to the candidates, the traditional mass media that are remediating the brand, and finally the public response on social media, which gets at the social intelligence model, really, from Moe and Schwedel. So what did we do? Okay, so we noticed that Republicans were resisting our research agenda. We polled five areas. Economy, healthcare, immigration, Iran, and a set of personality keywords very much paralleling what you were talking about, you know, strong and things like that. And we used data from what we called the early primary, which encompassed, it was right after some of the most racist comments of the Trump campaign at that time. And it went into the Republican debates. So we did have a fair bit going on. So what did we find? So it's really interesting that you talked about the candidates on Twitter, because we did find some interesting differences, which we'll show. So we looked at both how the candidates, using these five categories that were defined by keywords, economy, healthcare, immigration, Iran, which was a thing then, and personality. And then because of my deep nerddom roots in mass media, and also because of the spaceship model, we were also interested in how the mass media were covering them. And we used newspapers as proxies. Okay, well, it quickly became obvious that whether you looked at Twitter or traditional mass media, this is all anyone was talking about. They were talking about Trump and immigration. It didn't matter if you looked at what people were tweeting. Well, Clinton wasn't tweeting about this, which is interesting. But what Trump was tweeting, what supporters were tweeting about, or anti-supporters were tweeting about, what was covered in the mass media was that. So in the end, I would say, our work becomes much less a question, and I'm going to go into some more, I don't know why the conclusion slide's in the middle, it just happened, but we'll roll with it. Becomes less a question about social media analytics and much more a question about media logic, which is good because I teach in a journalism school. Okay, so this is what happens if you take, so we looked at these tweets over a period of about 50 days, and you can, I don't know how clear the numbers are at the side, but that top number is of 20 on both sides. So they're not tweeting an enormous amount. This is their official Twitter handles. But immigration is in green, and economy is in blue, and purple is the personality. So what you're seeing is obviously, you get a lot, it's very peaky, it's a very scientific term, right? So people tend to tweet around real world events, whether that's debates or speeches or things like that, you know, policy statements, reactions sometimes to tragedy. So Trump is mostly tweeting himself about immigration. You see, with Clinton, many more of the tweets are about the economy. So right away, we see a different personality fingerprint in terms of issues. Now, that's just the things that were about issues. Now, if I have this on the next slide. So this is how people were tweeting about their candidates. Now, this is only the tweets that included our keywords relating to economy, immigration, healthcare, Iran, and these personality words we had pulled out. So as you can see, unsurprisingly, when people were tweeting about the candidates, they mirrored what the candidates tweeted themselves. So that's kind of an interesting finding in the sense that there's this echo chamber. Now, what this doesn't say and what this should say is, were these tweets negative or positive? And we did use BrandWatch, and we did try to see, okay, can we get automated response about the sentiment of these tweets? Because that's important, right? Because it's not just volume, but are you being attacked or supported? And we couldn't, see, this is where you guys are ahead of us. We couldn't get a sentiment analysis that worked at that level. So we're just going with volume's important. That's our cover story, and we're sticking with it. But also you can see the rise of the purple. So there's a lot of tweeting that's just going on about supporting, or not supporting, about talking about the characteristics. Are they a strong person? You know, are they crooked Hillary? Things like that came up later. Okay, so that's all going on in the Twitter sphere, and we take the point that you should do more than Twitter. We are violating the tenets of Moe and Schwedel by not doing more than Twitter. However, despite valiant attempts to get more than Twitter, we kind of failed. So we're using Twitter, and we're going to stick with that. So we went back to the drawing board for traditional media. After some sad and pathetic attempts to do this automatically, I went back to my roots, and we downloaded about 450 articles from LexisNexis for the same time period using the same keywords. And then we coded them to see what the focus was. And we threw out editorials. We just used what we consider straight news. And as you can see, what is the issue that dominated in the traditional mass media coverage? Well, it was immigration all over the place, right? So the idea that Twitter or social media somehow fostered and nurtured Trump's discussion about immigration, I don't think there's a lot of evidence for that. I think the far more compelling evidence, this is the New York Times, the Washington Post, and USA Today. So we use this as proxy, sort of, for mass media in the country. I'm willing to take some flack on that one, too. But they're the ones who were talking about it. And Trump is getting all the oxygen, right? He's getting all the focus. And you read these articles, and if you were going to do sentiment analysis in general, and particularly with the New York Times, you would say there was a negative frame. You know, high schoolers decide not to hold prom in Trump property. You know, how workers at Trump properties feel about what Trump is saying. So if there was a way to kind of write a story that would highlight how outraged people were about this, they found it. But so here's where I go with this argument, and here's the conundrum that faces us today. So I really think the evidence suggests that in our spaceship model, where we deliberately put traditional mass media at the center of the model, is that yes, the mass media are a huge engine for generating discourse and framing within the election. Well, that's not exactly headline breaking news. Particularly, we political communication scholars have known that for a long, long time. But what's interesting is how central it remains in an era of social media, and how little we really understand, in a sense, how much of the political brand is still owned by the traditional mass media, owned by the candidate, or really owned by the citizens on social media. And so, you know, if you really think about this, the real research question becomes, why are certain ideas sticky? Why do certain narratives find resonance in the US political media sphere and others don't? And I used to kind of think it was sort of an alchemy, or there was, you know, some sort of, but I think it actually relates, and unsurprisingly from someone from a journalism college, I still think the mass media are holding a central role in how this discourse plays out. And in my last minute or two, I think that was my last slide, oh yes it was, I just like to think about, I'd love to talk about this during the discussion of how do you take that forward? How do the mass media play a role in promoting a civic discourse in times when a candidate himself is not promoting a civic discourse? What is the proper role of the media here? And how much should one try to take on a role of social responsibility and say that, you know, in point of fact, these elections are free and fair, and they are going to generate a result that we should all respect, and how much do you cover the candidate's speech that you know is going to get more hits and more buzz because he's saying something that's outrageous? So I'll leave it at that.
All right, thank you. So our final presentation is from Dr. Lindsay Hayes, who is an actual practitioner, so I'm very interested in hearing her perspective on this. Dr. Hayes received her PhD from the University of Maryland in 2013, and she's held communications-related positions at the White House, the U.S. Senate, and in a cabinet-level agency of the U.S. government. And since 2007, she's been a speechwriter for congressional and presidential campaigns. Dr. Hayes got her start in the White House Office of Speech Writing, where she assisted President Bush's writers with research and annotation. In 2002, late Alaska Senator Ted Stevens gave Hayes her first business card level writing job. And in 2008, she served as a Republican National Convention senior writer and was a member of the McCain-Palin speechwriting team. In 2012, she was the director of speechwriting for the Romney-Ryan campaign. And in 2014, she assisted U.S. House Speaker Paul Ryan with the manuscript for his book, The Way Forward, which became a New York Times bestseller. In between campaigns, she has taught classes here at the University of Maryland's Department of Communication, and she currently assists clients through her firm, Redpath Writing, and is working on a documentary film and a book about women in politics. Both of those are scheduled for release in early 2018. Her talk is entitled, Every Good Speechwriter Hates Twitter. How snaps, gifs, selfies, posts, tags, and tweets have changed political speechwriting. Dr. Hayes.
For inviting me here today. I don't have anything nearly as smart as what came before me, but I'm gonna try to make up for that with like good anecdotes. I also apologize, I'm a little under the weather, so this will be, there will be fewer hand gestures. I guess I'm a little more subdued and on cold medicine. I guess I approach this topic differently in the sense that I am in a unique position in both that I have an academic background and I do have a professional writing background in politics, but also I am like a dinosaur. So in the interest of full disclosure, we don't have to talk about years and dates here, we can just go with general technology milestones. When I arrived at college, people walked around talking about this amazing new thing called email. And you had to go to the library and stand in a line at an email station. And when you got to the front of the line, you had all the time in the world, but not really, because there was the pressure of all of the people behind you waiting at the email station to craft your own intimate thoughts and send them to people that you cared about. Who you didn't care enough to call or to write. And I promptly did that once, and then I thought, why would anyone ever do this? This won't last. And I started, I went back to everything I was doing before I came to college for 4 years. And so I wrote letters, and I made phone calls, and I researched in books and libraries. My first job was at a high-tech PR firm out of college in Boston, and obviously given my experience with email, that's like not the best fit to be doing high-tech PR when you're like, what's the use of email? The first day, somebody actually introduced me to the concept of researching on the internet. So he said, we have the World Wide Web here. We're connected, we're cool. And I thought, what is that? And so he showed me, and he opened up, you know, a Safari internet browser, probably, or an Internet Explorer browser, and he said, just put stuff in. You can find anything. And so I, being, you know, the very tech savvy, you know, a very kind of interested person I am, I promptly used it to do all the things I used to do before I read the Boston Globe online. And so I came to the University of Maryland. High-tech PR was not a good fit, and so I had to get out of there. So I came to the University of Maryland. I was 23. I got very lucky because I got Dr. Shawn Parry-Giles as my advisor. She's been one of the biggest influences on both my thinking about all of the work that I do and on my writing, my life as a writer. But I did a couple of other things that were important. I read Peggy Noonan's book, When I Sought the Revolution, which is about speech writing in the Reagan administration, and a light bulb went off and I thought, that's a job, I think I could do that job, because I'd always been interested in politics, but I didn't really have a niche where I could fit in. And then, right here on the University of Maryland campus, I met my first live, in the flesh, speechwriter, which if you're doing speechwriting well, it's very hard to find a speechwriter because we like to be anonymous. We're like endangered species. Like if you see us out, like at a Starbucks, it's like, oh, yeah, there they are. And so it was a guy by the name of Ed Walsh, and it was right after 9/11 and right after anthrax, and the White House was having a hard time getting internship applications because people didn't want their kids to be at the White House post 9/11, and also because of anthrax, all of the paper applications were getting sent up where some poor guy in a hazmat suit was opening them to, like, you know, just the lottery, you know, maybe this will be real, maybe it'll be deadly. And so I went ahead and actually Sean's husband, he was explaining all of this to us, the speechwriter, and Sean's husband said, well, Lindsay will do it. And he said, would you really want it? And I said, of course, yeah. And I was in the first year of my PhD program. And so from there, at the White House, I did research. And we did a combination of online research. We used a lot of LexisNexis, but they obviously have a very impressive collection of books. And so the first time I ever saw Dick Cheney in the flesh was actually headed to the library, a story I'm happy to tell if you want it. But I went to the White House and I went to the US Senate for 4 years. I then went to the Department of Health and Human Services and wrote for the secretary there while the Bush campaign was doing like their version of Obamacare, which wasn't successful, obviously, because now we have Obamacare. But it was a great learning experience. I did that for a year. And then I made the flip into politics because I was young enough and I didn't have a mortgage. And the only thing I was really responsible for was maintaining my marriage and a dog. And so I decided, like, I could, this was really the time in life to do it. So I took a job out at the Republican National Convention in Minneapolis, St. Paul, moved out there temporarily. And on the last night, I saw somebody I knew who was on the speechwriting team. And you have to think Sarah Palin post that convention speech. So this is the next, this is within 24 hours, not everything that's come to follow. And he said, do you want to get on the plane with Palin through the end? And I said, yeah, I would love to do that. So I was living on the plane for the last 3 months of the campaign. And then I've done other things in between, but the big highlight, I guess, is probably the Romney Ryan campaign in 2012, where I was the director of speechwriting and then got to work with Paul on his book. And so my evolution as a practitioner, as a speechwriter, has kind of closely tracked with the evolution of social media. I can remember Ted Stevens, who was in his 70s when I worked for him, and he was very proud that even though he was one of the older guys, he, in the Senate, he was very tech savvy. So he was one of the first senators to get a BlackBerry. Like, whoa. That was like a doorstop that he lugged around. And then one day, I'd actually been promoted to his communications director, so I was doing all of his writing and overseeing all his communication strategy, and he was in the leadership of the Senate, chair of the Commerce Committee at this point, and the senior senator for the state of Alaska. And he came back and he said, I just heard in the Republican cloakroom about this new thing, and we need to do it. And I said, he said, I have to have a block. And I said, I don't think you need a blog, because he definitely, I was like, we can have a blog, but you can't write it, because he was in his late 70s, and he would say things that just popped into his mind. For example, at one point, I got a call from some reporters, and they said, do you have any comment on what the senator said in the gaggle today? And I said, no, you know, I don't have any comment. And then I thought, because I don't know what he said. And so someone came back from having been in the gaggle outside the Senate luncheon, and I said, what did he say? I'm getting all these calls from people. They want to know if I have comment. And they said, well, they were asking him about the timing of the appropriations bills and when we could expect to see those on the floor. And he said, hell if I know. I'm in my late 70s. I am hungry at midnight and sexy at noon. And so you want to talk about a tweetable quote. So I then got calls and I said, no, I think it speaks for itself. It's, you know, pretty clear on how he feels. And then of course, you know, in 2008 when I went to the convention, we did have like a more robust social media operation, but it was really web, geared to the web and to video. So it was just basically doing what we had done before, but making it more accessible. And then in 2009, I think, is when I really noticed the shift. Not so much on the campaign, but afterwards. I can remember seeing Robert Gibbs talk to, and he did a piece, Robert Draper did a piece after that election, and Robert's a great writer and smart guy, and, you know, Robert Gibbs, who was at the White House with Obama at that point, said, social media has changed everything. You know, Sarah Palin can literally send a tweet from her living room in Wasilla, Alaska, and I walk into the White House briefing room, that's all anybody wants to talk about. And so we started to see, I think, that impact. It really started to shape up, I think, around Obamacare. And then in 2012 was probably the first time I really felt the impact. You know, I've always felt the impact and the effect of my work, but I've never really felt the impact on the writing process itself. But I remember during the primary, I had somebody from the strategy side of the campaign come up to me, and they said, they were looking at this manuscript that was like fully developed, good argument, and they said, where's my tweet? And I thought, there's 18,000 words here. Like, you want 140 characters, you know? And so you had to start thinking that way. And so there are five reasons why I hate social media. The first is that it does impact the writing process. Like, DC is very Twitter focused, and so everybody starts speaking to that audience, and they have that audience in mind, but that audience is actually very narrow. It does not represent large swaths of America, particularly millennials. The Twitter numbers on millennials are lower than, say, an Instagram or Snapchat. And so when you start playing to that, what you're doing is you're confusing social media strategy, which you should definitely have to amplify the message, with writing all your content for social media. So the purpose of the speech writing process is not to get tweets. That's the purpose of the social media strategy department. My job is to give you a fully formed, well thought out, factual argument that you're gonna make publicly. It also adopts the language of the internet, which I think is very damaging, and I think we've seen a lot of that in this campaign. The internet is not like typically a fun, happy place. You go look on Yelp, anybody who has a review on there can attest to that. And so there's a lot of kind of insular thinking, and when you start confusing what's on Twitter with what the general public feels about you and your campaign messaging, that can really kind of skew your worldview. The second thing I hate about it is that nobody watches the whole speech anymore, and this is especially true of reporters. I can't tell you how disheartening it is to sit there and watch reporters live tweet throughout a speech, because that changes the entire experience. You are not listening to an entire argument and evaluating it. You are half in, half out, and you're also, there are times where I see them tweeting, I'm like, that, no, that's not your tweet yet. Like, wait, you know, give it a minute. And so it's also just completely devoid of context. They'll send out 140 characters, and it's like, that's not even relevant to the bigger argument that we're making. And then the third is the death of facts. So we take facts very seriously in every shop that I've ever worked in. Part of that's because I come out of the White House and the training and the research operation there. And it's very upsetting to watch, you know, people counter your speeches with things that are facts that you dismissed very early on because you know them to be unreliable. And Trump has done a lot of this with this polling argument, where they are just continuing. CNN's gotten better recently about calling them on this. You know, no, the polls don't show Donald Trump winning. Online polls, self-selected, which are really just another form of social media, us all getting together and like clicking Trump 500 times. And by us, I don't mean me. But, you know, that is not a factual scientific poll. And so we can have a debate about facts, and there are debates about facts. You know, it just increasingly seems to me that with social media, those debates and arguments are completely untethered from, there's no good process. We have tons of fact checkers, but there's really no good process to kind of evaluate all of that. And then the fourth reason I hate it is because everyone's a star. So this all started with The War Room, with a documentary that aired when I was in college, and it made James Carville and George Stephanopoulos and Mary Matlin kind of household names, and it covered the Bush and Clinton campaign. And I confess, I love The War Room. It definitely piqued my interest in being on campaigns. But the problem with that, particularly for speech writers, is anonymity. You know, we function best when we function behind the scenes. It's not that I'm giving Mitt Romney words to say and he's getting up and saying them. We are engaged in a collaborative process where he says, this is something I want to say, and I say, gee, did you think about tweaking it like that? Or actually, I saw this interesting thing, or what about that person you met on the campaign trail? Shouldn't we work that in? And one of the things that I think is really dangerous about social media generally is that it takes what started with The War Room and it really blows it out, because what happened is, soon campaigns started to figure out that all of us who work on campaigns, that we are outlets for the message. We have our own Twitter accounts. I don't, but you know, a lot of campaign staffers do. And so you've got to fill that. And the way you fill that and the content that you put out there, that makes people super interested in you. And the more that people are focused on Uma Abedin and her marital problems, the less they are focused on Hillary Clinton and her policy proposals. And also, by the way, it kind of sucks to be Uma Abedin. I mean, who really wants, just because by virtue of being on a campaign, people now know you and you're tweeting and you're putting things out there supporting the campaign, doesn't mean that you now want to be at the level of scrutiny as if you were running for office yourself. So I think that that's kind of bad news. I think it's also dangerous. If you go back and you read, Matthew Scully did a piece in The Atlantic after the Bush administration wrapped up. He was a writer in the speech writing shop there. And he made this, it was called President the Creation, and it's all about Mike Gerson, who's the chief speechwriter for President Bush. And at the time it was seen as this hit piece, and that's really, I know Matthew, and that's not really how he meant it. He was making a broader point that the media had made Michael Gerson into a star. And they had made him kind of, you know, this idea that he was Bush's spiritual compass and, you know, kind of the like adjunct part of Karl Rove's brain and, you know, that could put all this stuff into language. And the issue with that is twofold. One, when you do that, you wind up having people ask questions about, well, whose speeches are those and whose ideas are those, right? And even on Amazon, this is something Matthew points to, President Bush's 9/11 speeches, there were several of them where they were bound and sold, and Mike Gerson is listed as the author on Amazon. And that's, I just think, incredibly problematic. The other thing is that it hurts morale. A lot of writing when you get to the presidential level is team writing. And if one person is out there getting all the credit, you know, in the Twitter sphere, it really damages the morale inside, because I'm willing to give up my anonymity for this cause and this candidate. I'm not willing to give up my anonymity and which parts I contributed so that you can go get a book deal. So that I think is a tremendous, it has a really negative effect internally. And then the final is, I find social media allows us to confuse authenticity with just plain crazy. So you get up and you're saying stuff about a former Miss Universe and you do it in an interview and people are kind of like, whoa, that was weird. You tweet it at 3 a.m. and all of a sudden it becomes like your real authentic thoughts. And we're so kind of, I think, disillusioned with the idea that these are packaged events, that everything is scripted, we've poll tested every bit of language, which, by the way, if you've ever worked on a campaign, it is not like that. It's all just kind of catch as you can, and you're flying by the seat of your pants. And I always see these things come out like, they must have planned that. I'm like, oh, if only I had time in my day to plan anything like that. But I think that everybody kind of feels like in this reality media environment, right, we all know how the show is made. And so we're desperate for these moments of authenticity. And Sean's done a ton of work on this with Hillary Clinton. And I just have to say, like, I think that's part of what's going on with Trump, is we're so excited that he seems authentic. He says what he wants. He doesn't, you know, he refuses to be kind of controlled by his campaign team. And then it's pretty clear, the tweets that are written from him, because they're at 3 a.m. and it's just this like crazy stream of conscious. We're so enamored of kind of that style. It's so shocking and different that nobody really, and I think the media especially, has not done a really good job of drilling down on the substance of those things and why that is dangerous for the country and why it's dangerous for the presidency. And I say this as a Republican, with 3 weeks to go to an election. But I've been really, I think what we're seeing is him using social media in lots of ways that have actually kind of broken down the system and broken down discourse. And we need to kind of evaluate that, I think, as we go forward. Thank you.
All right, it seems to have cooled off a little in here.
Yay!
And we've got a good amount of time left over for questions and discussions, so I would just like to open the floor. My colleague Eric Lindquist has a microphone, so just raise your hand if you have a question or a comment, and he will come to you.
Somebody has to have a comment or a question.
Yes, good.
My question, if anyone relates to polling,
talk about what impact does the polling that the campaign is doing as it relates to the speech or whatever else. Comment about the polling.
I want to hear what you have to say about polling, but from a political science point of view, there's been a lot of people being pretty upset that we've turned into horse race elections, right? So it's all about, instead of talking about the issues and the substance or even the character, so ahead, behind, it's like turned into a big game. And I have to say, you know, speaking of things that haven't been helped by the social media, that it does seem like there's this huge emphasis on polling. The one thing I do like about the internet and polling is I like that you can go to websites that actually explain the Electoral College. That is one thing. And I found the 538 site, obviously very left-leaning, extremely helpful. But that's kind of the takeaway from the nerd point, that political communication specialists are always saying, can we please stop pretending this is, you know, like a horse race, and let's talk about the issues. Because the concern is if you say, oh, well, so-and-so's up by, you know, a margin of 20%, then people don't vote. It's like we're actually disengaging citizens by turning it into a game.
I don't listen to pollsters or hang out with pollsters. I like one pollster, I do, but she's wrote a book. It's actually, you should read it. It's called The Selfie Vote. It's by Kristen Soltis Anderson, who's a Republican pollster who's done a lot of work. She is a millennial herself and has done a lot of work about the Republican Party and its disengagement with millennials. But that's really it. And the reason is because polls, I'm not a quantitative person. I barely got through that in grad school by the skin of my teeth. I'm words, not numbers. But I will say that once you've taken that, you've seen how these things are constructed, you start to have a real appreciation for an understanding about the impact that assumptions people make when they kind of, you know, put in, at some point, determinations have to be made. You know, how likely do we think it is that this group will actually vote? How likely, you know, how, and so those variables are, you're basing it, it's an educated guess, but in a lot of ways it's a guess, and I can't, as a speechwriter, bank on that. So what I have to always assume is that I am persuading. I am trying to persuade people to either turn up and vote, to be excited about their candidate, or to convince people who are skeptical that they should vote for that candidate. And I'll give you a good example. In 2012, there's been a lot of conversation, and I get asked about this a lot. How did they not, you know, Mitts come out several times and said, we really didn't know until election night that we were going to lose this thing. And I've had a lot of people ask me, how didn't you know? And my answer is the speechwriting shop knew, because we don't have the luxury of sitting around and looking at all these polls and thinking it's going well. We are constantly trying to turn out voters. We are constantly trying to convince voters to vote for us. And that doesn't stop. You know, if we win by a ton, great, we really did our job. But that requires you to keep your finger on the pulse a little bit more and not kind of hide behind the numbers, because the numbers are only a great snapshot of the campaign at that exact moment. It can change so quickly. And there's been a lot of issues with polling, especially with cell phones and people who are completely off the grid. Who's likely to get on a phone and actually answer all of these questions? There's all kinds of, all kinds of concerns about people. This is the concern about Trump right now, that potentially his numbers are actually higher. I mean, it depends on where you fall on the political spectrum, but people who are concerned about a Trump presidency, everyone was walking around and saying, oh, Hillary's now going to these Republican places, and it looks like, you know, she's gonna take it from him. But there is a concern that when you call people and you say, are you gonna vote for Trump, they're saying no because they know that that's not really a socially acceptable answer in a lot of ways, and they're concerned about your judgments of them, but they are going to vote for him. And so all of those things are things that, as a writer, when I'm thinking about audience, I have to be thinking about. And in 2012, that in fact was the problem. It wasn't just external polling. Because all the external polls were showing us that it was very tight in places where, you know, we needed to win. But the internal polling was telling us that we were winning. And I just never bought that. I thought it's Obama, it's, you know, yeah, you can make your arguments about the economy, what have you, but at the end of the day, like, it's, you know, our first African-American president. You know, he's very inspirational. You may not like the policy things that he's done, but if you're into that policy, then yeah, you're really happy. I mean, he's moved the needle on important policy issues like healthcare. And it turned out that, you know, we had election night and everybody was like completely crushed. And those of us in the speech writing operation were like, yeah, my desk was already packed. Like, I don't know what you're talking about. And it made it kind of hard because you're walking around and people are taking this. Like, I mean, people are crying. And I just didn't have that feeling because I kind of always knew I didn't think we were as close as people thought. But it turns out our pollster, the data massively overstated the case with Obama voters. In other words, what they thought, the assumption they put into the data is that Obama could not replicate the turnout that he did in 2008. And so if you went back to a turnout among first-time voters, among certain communities, if you went back to the assumption that they would vote the same as they always had in 2008, it was a blip, then yeah, it looked like Romney could win. But that's not what happened, because the Obama campaign had a great ground game and they were successful. So for all those reasons, I know everybody thinks that poll testing language and, you know, we try to find the exact phrase, and there's a little bit of that. We get polling reports that tell us, like, you know, don't use this term, use this term. But for the most part, I just stay away from it because it's not really a helpful tool.
Yeah, if I could add to that, I write polls and I know that they're in exact science, but I agree with you. I do, because we all know, right, we've talked to people about why are you voting, and there's a lot of dislike in this election, and in fact the Pew Research Center has said the main reason people would vote for Trump is because they hate Hillary Clinton, and the main reason they vote for Hillary Clinton is because they hate Donald Trump. Like, we're not being driven by affection for a third of the voters. So I think that's kind of unprecedented, really. I mean, there's always been a lot of hate in American elections, let's be realistic. But this level is incredible and on both sides. So at the end of the day, when it comes to election day, are people just going to sit at home and go, well, you know, I don't want to vote because this is how I feel? I hope that, you know, you always hope in a country that people will go out and express their preferences. But I agree with you. I think particularly a lot of people will not talk about Trump anymore. And that's, you know, that's problematic.
I have a question over here.
The first is just more an observation. In using the term social media, it really seemed like it's all about Twitter, as opposed to Instagram or Facebook. But the other sort of question I have is, yeah, DC is Twitter-centric, but I mean, we're a huge country, and yet are the sort of media writes about all these tweets all the time, but how are we really getting a sense of the country if we're looking at tweets, which are only like such a small part of that? I mean, I used to have a Twitter account, and I deleted it because it's so nasty. So, just curious.
I think that question is spot on. So I've been thinking about that issue quite a bit lately. Most of my social media research is contained in the social media sphere, and there are definitely differences across the different platforms. So not only are tweets different from Facebook comments, they're different from discussion forums, they're different from blogs, and even within each one of those platform types, there's deviation depending on who the audience, which specific site you're on. So there's differences in audience effects. People tend to gravitate to audiences that they're comfortable speaking to, whether that's because everyone else has the same opinion or because they want to establish themselves as an expert in the group. Whatever the reason, the choice of where to speak on social media is related to their own opinion. And so, you know, I've taken that idea, and so Twitter is definitely not representative, and so there are things that as pollsters, as analysts, as surveyors, we need to think about when we try and gauge sentiment or gauge opinions by looking at multiple sources, right? Having said that, that's still within the realm of social media, and so I've been thinking about this from a larger macro perspective. And it used to be, you know, that we had three major networks in this country, right? And with those three major broadcast networks, there was some uniformity in opinions and values and preferences that we were conveying. And I think I've even seen some communications research that has shown that the invention of TVs was really what brought people together to share with a shared value system in this country, right? And I've been teaching media for a while now in the context of business. And one of the things that advertisers always have to think about is that over time, we've moved away from those three TV networks, and we have cable networks, and we have specialty networks, and now we've got, then we had digital channels and websites, and now we have all of these social media accounts where, what was the quote, everyone is a star, right? And so the impact of that is that from a marketing business person standpoint, the brand's goal is to use all of that data and try and identify the people who you're targeting. You're not trying to reach everyone, you're trying to find the person that is most responsive to the product that you're offering. That's where it falls apart when we start talking about politics and government, because we can't just tailor our message to one specific group of individuals. It needs to be more wide-reaching. Because everyone has their own audience, we're getting these little pockets of discussion, and there's that mass media that used to unify the population isn't there anymore. And I think that's probably part of the source of this fragmentation and the extremity of some of the conversation going on right now.
Anybody wants to add to that? Somebody had a question here.
So this question is for Professor Oates and Professor Moe. You mentioned using the different social media platforms and not just focusing on one to collect your data and information from. So, you know, I noticed last night, for example, Facebook announced that Trump just shattered records for the most number of mentions ever in the history of Facebook. So how does the two media platforms differ in terms of effectiveness? How does the Facebook shattering records counter that of Twitter? And also, what is kind of the net positive impact of this? Is, you know, him, Trump, shattering records, gathering more votes for him, this awareness generating people to want to vote for him, or, you know, someone that's not in the election and has no idea what's going on and they see this headline, are they more inclined to support him or vote for him?
Well, I think those are really good questions, and you're actually, you know, you're sitting next to Stephen Witowski, who's like, please don't ask that, because he's our GA, and we're going to make him get all that data, so, you know, you're throwing him under a bus. So, you're asking a question about, you know, what does it mean? You know, is this just noise that, you know, there's all this volume of mention of Trump? Is it positive? Is it negative? We don't know. I know from, well, all three of us on the project know from looking at content casually, like reading a bunch of it, a lot of it's going to be negative. So will it all kind of just wash out, right? The negatives and the positives? Will people suddenly encounter surprising things about Trump or about Clinton that they didn't know and change their mind? No. I mean, that sounds like a horrible thing to say since I got money to study social media. But I look at it this way, and this is classic, and this will be very familiar to Sean. Classic voter behavior. It sits on a big base of who we are as people, our socioeconomic preferences, and our party affiliation. And that is usually established in childhood. So going forward in life, you know, we have a pretty strong set of predetermined orientation. It does change somewhat sometimes, but in general, that's it. So in each individual campaign, you know, issues come in, and we have these choices among candidates. At this point, it's difficult to see how even a large volume of tweets or Facebook comments are doing anything except enforcing existing beliefs rather than changing. So I would love to take all those, use some of the fabulous software / methodology that you guys have, and say, okay, well, are any of these attempting to persuade or argue? I don't think they are. I think they're just self-reinforcing views, or as you pointed out, just being nasty sometimes. How many of us have muted a couple of people on Facebook lately? Oh yeah. So that's my point as well. Did you want to address that?
I am going to add to that though. So I think there are two types of people who vote. One type thinks pretty hard about it, another type, the other type doesn't. And so I think in general, there are, and for any issue, for any topic, those two types of people exist. When we start thinking about sentiment, when we start thinking about what are people's opinions about particular candidates and their platforms, we're talking about the folks that are thinking pretty hard. And it's sad to say, but I believe that that's a minority in the population. And so relating that to the polling comment earlier, I think in the polling, and when we look at sentiment, that gets to how do we feel about, what's our opinion about a candidate. But if we think about a brand, the success of a brand is more than how much you like the deliverables of that product. It's also a big function of how many people are talking about you, does that brand pop up in your environment? How many people are aware that this brand even exists? And so to that extent, the number of likes and Trump's presence is huge. So he's a very successful brand. Maybe generating negative sentiment, but only amongst those who are thinking hard about it.
So this is why it's fun to work with her, because we just look at it. Yeah, we're gonna have to synthesize this for the end of the grant. But it's depends. Do you view it through the lens of a brand or the lens of me as a traditional political scientist who's like, oh my God, no, they have predetermined childhood, based sentiment.
But going back to the initial part of the question, so I'm piecing together all the different parts slowly, right? Of if it's which is more effective, is Facebook or Twitter. I think social media makes it easier for brands in this context specifically, to generate a lot of buzz, to generate a large presence, but also not offending individuals too much because you can't target all the social media. So on Facebook, you can say, I only want to send this message to people who have a certain profile, both in turn, and you can look at what people's characteristics are, their age, where they live. You can also look to see what they've said in the past and target your message to them. So if I were running the Trump campaign, I would definitely target my Facebook messages that have content and identify those individuals on Facebook and send those specifically to those individuals. But for everyone else, for the general consumption tweets or Facebook posts, they would be a little bit more generic, right? And then that would both raise your awareness and also really feed into that base. So that's something that I think prior to social media, it was more difficult to do, in that in the primaries you focused on the base, in the generals you had to spread your wings a little bit more. But that made conflict, that resulted in a message that had to change over time. With social media, you can definitely target the message more clearly in the beginning when you need to reach your base and then kind of branch out a little bit more. So that's my opinion as a brand marketer, not as a political person at all.
Just a comment on the negativity. I mean, look, it's just a political campaigning fact that negative works. It tends to really damage candidates that it's leveled against. Just ask Michael Dukakis. That race was pretty nasty. It was on par in some ways with this. Different subjects, different. But, certainly you saw a lot of those themes kind of work their way through there. And Bush won. And so the key is, but the other thing about it is that negative campaigning drives down voter turnout. And so, look, I'm not in the Trump campaign. I was actually, an interesting fact, called the week before Trump announced, and somebody I knew who was a colleague from another campaign said, I wanted to know if you were up for a job in the 16 campaign. I have someone who's about to announce. I can't tell you who it is, but it's a businessman from New York. And I politely kind of backpedaled out of the conversation and said, I'm sure you'll find someone amazing. And largely, by the way, a big part of the reason that I did that is I made a conscious decision after 2012 that I was not going to work any campaigns in the 2016 cycle. Because as a writer, this becomes very dangerous. It's like the echo chamber of being on Twitter or being on Facebook or tailoring your media consumption so you only watch MSNBC or you only watch Fox. You start to lose contact with what you were saying, that it's a big country and people have lots of opinions and lots of ways they get news. And so in terms of the impact, it's been a great experience to sit back and watch 2016, not as somebody working in the political cycle, but as somebody who is just at home deciding who to vote. And I think in terms of impact, what would actually be really interesting to look at is Republicans who are not enamored with Trump, because that is a place where I think the social media usage actually has had an impact, and it's been a very negative one. So those of us who are in the party and have been kind of troubled all along by his behavior in the primary, and everybody kept saying, oh, well, don't worry, if he becomes the nominee, he'll become more presidential, and I mean, we see how that went. You see him have a moment, I've seen him have moments in the debates where he, you know, I guess this is the whole, like, you trap, 100 people in a room with a typewriter and eventually you get the great American novel. I mean, I've seen moments in debates where I'm like, yeah, okay, that's a policy position I recognize and I might support, not the wall, but some kind of basic, basic level conservative thinking going on there. And then the next day, he'll be tweeting about Miss Universe, or he'll be, or the video comes out about, groping women, and we'll keep this PG, and then he comes out and talks about it as if it's locker room talk, that locker room should be abolished. I mean, that's just crazy. And so the minimizing of it, and he does that repeatedly, he goes on Twitter, he is very much of the mindset that any publicity is good publicity, and that has served him well in an entertainment brand. There will really be a question on November 8th, I'm really not working the cycle because that would be ingrained in my brain, but I think that will be a huge referendum on this, right? He's basically taken the brand that is, you're fired is not like a nice thing to say to people. So it's a little callous, and that's what we like. We like the way he delivered it, but do you like it in your politics? My thought about it is that it may be more strategic than we understand, because I've been on a couple panels this election cycle where people said, he's so authentic, and actually I kind of wound up making news by accident because a McClatchy reporter was in the audience at one of these panels and I didn't know there was any press. And I kind of got frustrated and I said, if this is authentic, I'll take fake every day of the week. And it became like the headline. So I thought, well, I guess it's out, I'm not a big Trump supporter. But I do think that it's interesting to look at Republicans. As somebody who's had to go back and forth this election cycle, and you start to see signs that, okay, maybe he's pulling it together and he could actually lead the country. And then you look at the tweet and it's largely the social media stuff that is the huge turnoff for us, where we just can't get over it. He follows it up with a lot of stuff that he says on the stump, but it kind of starts there. And so I think that would be an interesting, because I think that is a place that it's had an impact. And I also think that it is strategic in the sense that he's crazy, but I think he's crazy like a fox, right? Like he is, I think that they understand internally there, especially with Steve Bannon from Breitbart now in that campaign, that the Republican Party is facing a demographic challenge. We have not addressed that. We have not gone into communities of color in the way that we should have. We have not reached out to women in the way that we should have. And we just keep running elections, hoping we can churn out enough of this ever-shrinking base to win. And the proof is in the pudding on that. If Mitt Romney had run in 2004 and gotten those numbers, he would have won. So I think that there may be a recognition within the Trump campaign that the only way to really win this thing is to keep numbers down. And the way that you do that is negative campaigning, because people get discouraged and they're disheartened and they don't like her, but they don't like him, and so nobody shows up. And there may be a strategy there. I think Mark Halpern and John Heilman will write a book about it, and we'll all find out later. But that may actually be part of the strategy, because it's become very hard for Republicans to thread the needle through those swing states without doing that.
I would just add to that. I think that the other big piece of social media is a repetition, and repetition has always been important to politics. You say it over and over again, and they could redo that in the ads. 30 seconds, but now you can do it in 140 characters. So you lie, she lies, she lies, she lies, and then everybody says a Hillary Clinton. So everything's filtered through that. we all know she's a liar, and he just says it over and over, and she does it too, but I think he's gotten the repetition down. It's like, I'm just gonna say it at every event, America great again, I'm great, I'm great, I'm great, I'm great, and she's a liar. And if they take nothing else away, the voters, it's like, well, she lies and he's gonna make America great again. And that's, you know, it just gets synthesized to that.
Can I talk a wild card? Well, you know, if you're finding, I think the wild card here is, I agree with you, that's a classic, tell you have a PhD and the whole voter stuff, about negative. I think the feelings that some people have about Trump are new and different and deeper and angrier, because it's not just, they don't just feel he's attacked a candidate, which is kind of fair dues, okay, that's what you do. Well, he's attacked women, a woman, women, and now he's attacking democracy. And I think you see a sort of, you know what Democrats are like, generally kind of, you know, woolly and friendly, you know, sort of wolves in sheep's clothing, whatever. But they're very, I've never heard Democrats speak with the passion in the past couple of weeks that I've heard before. And so I don't think it's just negative. We need a whole new word for it, like vile.
Well, and by the way, there are a lot of us within the Republican Party who have been frustrated by the party's lack of ability to move into the new millennium and to actually go out and repair relationships with lots of communities. And I think that this is why I think it would be interesting to look at the impact of the social media on someone like me, who is, you know, either the people who were never Trumpers from the very beginning or those of us who are like, I'm going to wait and see. Because from a policy perspective, if we have a Republican House and a Republican Senate, I know McConnell and Ryan will keep him in check. And so that could, it's a very difficult needle to thread. You can imagine the cognitive dissonance. And yet at the same time, I can't go be a Democrat. I believe different things about the function of government. And so it's been a very difficult race, but I hear the same things in Republican circles. People are very upset. And I'll tell you, one of the most extraordinary, it's going to be the women of the Republican Party who change this, because one of the most unsettling and yet impactful moments I saw during this campaign was right after the video came out about the groping. Amanda Carpenter, Anna Navarro, and Tara Settmeyer were on CNN. And all women who have supported vastly different candidates. Anna is Hispanic, Latina. You have Tara Settmeyer is an African American woman, and then Amanda Carpenter is white and supported Ted Cruz. I mean, this is very right. And I watched them talk about this, and you know, make the point. This, what he is describing, is sexual assault. That is sexual assault, and like, we can't stand behind if the Republican Party's leaders are going to continue to act like that's not what he did. Then we, and Amanda Carpenter said, you know, we are starting to question, is this our ideological home? Can we stay here? And if not, where do we go? And so I do think that that's kind of a feeling across the board. One of the things that's interesting about being a Republican and consuming all of this is, what do you do with it? I mean, if you're this distressed, about all this messaging, and yet you're also distressed about the state of the country and you have different policy positions, that dissonance has been very real for lots of people. In a way, I really envy Democrats, because you get to sit back and just say, I think he's wrong, I think he's crazy, and I'm going to vote. I'm definitely showing up to vote the way I wanted to. For us, there's a lot of conversations among people like, who would you write in? You know, and poor Gary Johnson getting up and, you know, what's an Aleppo? I mean, you know, then you're like, well, that ship has sailed. Clearly that would be irresponsible. So I think it's just kind of an interesting, moment in the sense that I have a lot more in common when I talk politics right now with my friends who are Democrats than some of these people who have decided they're going to support Trump no matter what.
I would say that I think there's something that's similar to past elections, though, with Trump, and not the negative stuff where he's been racist, sexist, and all that. But I think he provides a sense of hope for people who feel like they have no other place to turn. And so, like many campaigns, that they just want change, that he is the change factor. So if you travel, I'm from the Midwest, you go back to the Midwest and you see these huge Trump signs in some of the most economically poor areas of the Midwest, and you say, how do they think that this man who's worked for himself all his these years is going to make your life better? But they feel like there's nowhere else. It's not going to be the Democrats, because it's just going to be an extension of Barack Obama. So I think this hope and change from 2008 is really kind of explains this phenomenon. And then, you know, how do you explain how they can continue to support? But I just really think that he might bring them economic advancement, and if that can happen, they're going to ignore the rest.
Well, I think it's a little bit more than that too, though. I think we are at a higher education institution in a very, very, very blue state. I would argue it's more liberal than California at this point. There are other parts of the country and other people in this population who have spent the past, I'm not in politics, so I don't know how long it's been since Bill Clinton was president, 16?
Yeah, we know this.
1993, I didn't do the math.
Many, many years. They spent all these years hating Hillary Clinton, mm-hmm. right? And as the as social media has popped up again, we're gonna bring it back to social media, they found those pockets to build on that hate and grow that hate. If she had disappeared and come back, maybe that hate wouldn't have built so much. I have no idea, it's a hypothesis, but she's been around making decisions and doing things, and that hate just keeps building.
I would say it just builds during the campaign. When she's in a role, her popularity tends to go up. So this is what happened, 60% when she stepped down as Secretary of State. And it just tipped down, because once you enter in that different space of politics, it's a whole new ball game, and it just reverts back. She's not authentic, she lies, and all the negativity.
And people hated her as First Lady too, right?
So. But they did, but a Senator and Secretary of State, especially, her approval ratings were pretty high, and she was reelected by large margins in New York.
State, right?
And I would just say on the social media side with the stuff with Hillary, I mean, look, you know, she is one of the most prominent women who's out there, and she's breaking a lot of glass ceilings, and so it's normal that there's going to be a lot of attention focused on her, especially from the gender perspective. I mean, some of the stuff that's going on the internet, you know, it's a deep, dark place, and there's a lot of vile stuff. But I worked for Sarah Palin, and if you think that we got a pass, I mean, there were literally pornographic films being made where women were cast who looked like Sarah Palin while we were in the election. And so, I mean, think about that, you know, and we've got our kids with us and all the rest of it. So there is, I think, and you see this too, right, not just in politics, in the gaming community and in the tech community, there's been a lot of conversation among female programmers and, you know, because that space is largely kind of hostile to women in lots of ways. And so there is something kind of about the internet where, like, the most vile stuff is allowed to be dumped because people think they have anonymity. But also it's just kind of the working out of people who know they can't say this stuff publicly, so they go here and they want to have that debate and challenge that. And I think that gender is one of the issues that you see that a lot on the internet, and I think politics is just it represents that larger gender issue,
and it's getting a bigger voice with
right.
the internet.
Yeah, absolutely.
Should we get a couple more questions? You had a question.
Hi, my question is about measuring public opinion. I thought it was interesting how a lot of your research measured public opinion by looking at Twitter, and then Dr. Hayes brought up a lot of the issues with Twitter, and then I was like, okay, well, we have polls, but then you guys listed a lot of problems with polling, so I was wondering what other alternatives there were.
Well, I think the point we're making is don't take it as gospel. If you're a social scientist for a while, you realize that nothing kind of works because people are not that predictable, but that I think you can get the architecture of broad trends. And I think you have to triangulate. I think you can look at a public opinion survey of 10,000 people across the United States, and that's going to tell you one thing. And I think that you can certainly look at volume and direction of comments on social media, and that'll tell you something else. But as, you know, as Lindsay will say, there's just, it's not over till the fat lady sings, right? If that's like still politically correct to say, I don't really know. But it's not over till election night, because until people actually get to that moment of voting, they can still change their minds. Voting is, and I think everyone on this panel would agree, voting is very emotional. It's not rational, so it's hard to find a way to measure it. That being said, as you pointed out, at some point the writing's on the wall, because it is, it's a game. At some point you can't win if your numbers go below a certain point.
Your numbers go below a certain point, and even if your numbers, and this is, I think, something we're going to see with Trump, and nobody's talking about this because he's just like a loose cannon and comes up with something new every week for us to be offended by, but they don't have a ground game. I mean, you know, that to me is really the sign that they're going to lose, is, you know, you kind of have this negativity. The negativity game in campaigns is negativity harms your opponent. It drives down voter turnout, which if you are not positioned to win, as the Republican Party has not been in a lot of national elections, can help your campaign. But the key is, for as you're throwing the mud, not to splash it all over yourself. And I think he is, I think he's very close, if not already. I think the bringing of the women from Bill Clinton's past to the last debate was, you know, really reflective of that, because if you're smart and you're organized, the way people tend to do this is they have surrogates make those arguments. You don't have the principal do it themselves. The VP role is typically, that's why Sarah Palin in a lot of ways, the negatives went way, way low, because she did. She served that role in 2008. There are other things, I could discuss those, other variables, but in particular, that, you know, that VP role, when you come out of it, if you don't win, you're lucky if you have a political career, because you, if you're doing the job right, you're the one throwing the mud and it's all over you. And so, you know, I think that that's like a serious question, is what's going to happen on election day. But his number, you know, I think he's tipped it in terms of the negativity. I think the mud is all over him. And then I also think that even if they were within striking distance in a lot of these swing states, they do not have the ground game, and the RNC has withdrawn a lot of support, which is what they were planning on for the ground game. So I have a hard time seeing it. But again, we've all been surprised by so many things this election cycle.
Can I ask a question we all want to ask, which is...
I don't want to dismiss all surveys and polls, I think...
Because that's our job.
If you have a very targeted, well-thought-out survey in the world of business or a poll in the world of politics, where you're working to de-bias, to not generate demand effects and allow people to really express their opinion and make sure you have a representative sample, then it's pretty accurate. Especially if you have a very focused group of people that you're trying to survey. The problem here in this election is that we're trying to poll a very broad realm of people, and so the diversity is making it harder. We have a new generation, the millennial generation. They don't do polls. They don't answer the phone. I don't answer any phone call from a number that I don't recognize anymore. And so that makes it a problem to use traditional polling methods. And so I think as the industry, we need to work toward using some other data sources.
Well, and the fact that we're so focused on social media is a sign that there is a problem with political polling, frankly, because what we're desperate for is any information that will give us some kind of real, you know, any process that will give us some kind of real data that we can look at and get insight into voters. And the polling process, I mean, you have seen in the last, you know, 5-6 years, people lose at astonishing levels when their pollsters just a week earlier were saying, oh, you know, you've got it in a landslide. Eric Cantor comes to mind in Virginia. I mean, that really like must have been a punch in the gut on election night, because they were convinced that he was not only on his way to victory, but very likely on his way to become Speaker of the House. And then the next day he was just like mowing his lawn. So I think that, but I think that this focus on it, I mean, polling is broken. We are not very good at it. It does not capture national sentiment a lot. Targeted is better. Nothing drives me crazier than these national polls. Nationally, Clinton is up. You know, that doesn't mean anything. On election day, you have to go state by state and precinct by precinct, and the states that matter the most are the swing states. And so there's a lot of just conversation about this, but I don't know that it always gives us insight. That's why social media is become this, like, we think in politics, oh, that's a window. And it's just a window into a specific group, which is to your point that all of these methods, observational, quantitative, it depends on the group that you're looking at, and you can't give you this broad swath that takes multiple polls over a very, or surveys over a very long period of time.
I want to ask a real brief question, and I know maybe the audience has other questions, but if Trump, this is for Lindsay, if Trump had been able to make the transition from celebrity to politician more effectively, like if he listened to his managers, could he have won this, would he be more likely to have won this election?
So there's an old Randy Newman song, it's called When You're a Fool in Love. And the line goes, you know, when you're a fool in love, seems like the skies are always gray. You turn around, there's someone in your way, and it's you. And I feel like Trump's in love with himself, and so that's probably a pretty apt line, because he is like a fool in love. I mean, he can't get out of his own way. I think there was a moment in here. Look, Hillary Clinton has a lot of issues as a candidate, and I don't say that as a partisan. I just say that as, because actually I respect her very much, but, you know, the Benghazi stuff is bad. The email stuff, I mean, any other candidate in any other election year having the email leaks like this just over and over and over, they would be looking at a very different November. But no one is really paying that much attention to that because Donald Trump can't get out of his own way. He, you know, the best thing for him would be to go and get low energy and like hang out in a hotel room and just allow this discourse about her performance as Secretary of State and some of these issues to play themselves out. And I think you'll see that tonight. I think he's going to go even further. They're bringing the mother of one of the Benghazi victims to the debate.
And Obama's half-brother.
And Obama's half-brother, which I'm not really sure why that affects Hillary, but
He's a Trump supporter.
Yeah, but I mean, again, as with so many things, it's a stunt, but, you know, but the thought process here is just simply that, you know, I think that there was a point of no return for me. And I'll tell you actually where that point of no return came, and it wasn't public. I actually had signed up like a year before the Republican National Convention I wasn't gonna work for a candidate, but I wanted to help and contribute. So I said, okay, I'll go back and do the job I did in 2008, which means I'll come in and on a contract, I will help you with your writing. No speeches. I'm doing talking points for surrogates. We're going to go on television, helping them understand and explain the message of the nominee. And then Donald Trump got elected. And nominated.
Stop it.
Cold medicine. Then Donald Trump got nominated, and I had this real moment. Like, am I going to show up and actually do this job? And I did for two reasons. One, I thought, I'm gonna get in there and really see what's going on in here, you know, and figure out, like, is there anything here that we can be proud of as conservatives, or is this just really what I think it is, which is a gong show? And then two, we have rising stars within the Republican Party who have very much grappled with how to deal with him. And Paul Ryan in particular has been in a very difficult position, and you've seen, it's, you know, that has been a very difficult dance for him. And
Disavow.
And so so I went to the convention because I thought, you know what, there are really good public servants who are going to be up there trying to do their part to communicate a Republican message to America. And I don't have any confidence about what they're going to get out of the Donald Trump campaign for talking points. And so we're just going to go with, we're going to make sure those people get on TV and they have the information that they need, and then they can disavow him, they can do whatever they want, but at least they have the content that they need to do it. And when I showed up, like 3 weeks before the convention, and had my first meetings with the Trump campaign, I was absolutely astonished. I mean, there was none of the policy materials, which may seem surprising to you, not seem surprising to you, but to someone like me, it's like, what have you guys been doing? What is going on here? No briefing book, no talking points, no surrogate list. I mean, it was a complete mess. And that really, for me, I'm offended by a lot of things he's said and a lot of things he's done. I think he's been incredibly damaging to the Republican Party, of which I am a part. But mostly, I think he's unfit to lead the country, because anybody who gets to their convention and doesn't have policies that I can look at to create talking points for people who are willing to go out and defend them, you know, somebody said to me, well, you know why he doesn't have that? He doesn't need them. He doesn't think he needs them to get elected. And I said, well, you know why he should have them? Because he needs them to govern. So that to me was the moment when I just thought, no, there's no way.
I think we have time for just one more question.
Hi, I'm a Humphrey Fellow. I'm a journalist from India. So this has been a new experience for us, the US presidential election. And it's it's all right.
It is always.
Yeah. I have two questions, slightly different. One is, how do you view social media as a source of news in terms of trust and credibility? And the second is that this policy of media organizations endorsing presidential candidates, how does it work in terms of fairness and objectivity?
Okay, I'll take that as the journalism professor. And okay, so the first one in terms of using Twitter as a source is quite problematic, and that's something that journalists in America are still kind of grappling with. Mostly, Twitter is a conversation among elites. There is some talk about, you know, trying to gauge public sentiment via Twitter or cherry-picking Twitter quotes to make a point. But it's not done particularly well. I haven't seen an awful lot of election stories that have really relied on Twitter in a scientific way. I think what journalists do, if they want their point backed up, they'll sort of find someone on Twitter who's saying it as well, which is not great. Fair enough, they do that with man in the street sometimes as well. The second question about endorsements is really, really interesting, because traditionally media organizations, particularly newspapers, have endorsed political candidates, but they claim there's a firewall between their editorial board endorsement and how they actually cover the candidate himself or herself. And candidates have complained. They said, well, how can you possibly be covering me fairly if you wrote in your newspaper you were supporting the other guy? So and there's always the argument coming back, well, we're objective, you know, we have an editorial board opinion, but our reporters follow a particular formula, so they're supposed to give everyone equal voice and balance. And most American, major American newspapers at least strive toward the objectivity norm, I would argue. And for all that Trump has complained about, he's not gotten fair coverage. First of all, he's gotten an enormous amount of coverage, which has helped him a lot, I think. And I think if you decode the articles, he is given a voice in a way that people in non-free states would go, wow, it's really amazing that you let your political opponents have this much voice. There has been a little bit of a wave of places like Vogue and The Atlantic coming out and endorsing Trump when they typically haven't done that. And that's reflective of a real crisis going on in journalism right now about what's our civic responsibility in this campaign. And we talked a little bit about that. So it's a good question. It is a weird American thing. I will admit that.
Okay, I guess we're out of time. We do want to announce the winner of the live tweet contest. So.
Oh, wow. So fast.
Thank you guys for participating in our live tweeting contest. We had, I think, upwards of 150 tweets on the hashtag, which is great. But yeah, it was tough picking a winner. There are a lot of great gifts. Definitely, if you get a chance, check out the hashtag when you get home. A lot of people were finding some funny stuff. But I have to give the prize, which is this Testudo 3D printed statue, to you. I hope they're still here. At Dr. R.B. Winkler.
Yeah, yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
You know, it was actually volume, I think. Yeah, we said.
I couldn't shut up.
We said it was a favorite tweet, and actually, kind of letting the internet vote on that, the most favorited tweet was actually Professor Oates' quote. It's still important, or it's important to tell academics what their limit will be, their time limit. So that was a student who I think left, and I might have to give her a separate prize. But thank you, guys.
All right, thank you, Aaron. All right, I want to thank all of our participants. Thank you for a really lively discussion and some great presentations. Thanks especially to Lily Greiner, who put this all together. My colleague Eric Kelsey. Is Kelsey still here? Kelsey Portland Rivera.
Yes.
And thanks to our videographers and chroniclers of the event. Thanks to the Learning Commons. And also, thank you, Judy. You were here when I thanked you for your She's not here yet. Where is she? I thought she was.
Oh, wow. So
she's still teaching. I thought I saw her earlier, but she snuck out again. All right, well, thank you all for coming, and hopefully we'll do this again in 2 years.